Assalamu alaikum. Very good morning to everybody. As we know that from the briefing from today's chair, MD Tanzil Hussain, the background of the today's webinar, I just like a little bit words about that. A project by International Food Policy Research Institute and Syngenta Foundation for Sustainable Agriculture identifies key drivers for the success of youth entrepreneurship in Bangladesh and examine challenges youth face in engaging in agribusiness. It highlights that Bangladesh has enacted policies and programs that support youth entrepreneurship and overall growth and development of the agricultural sector. But some policies do not provide any coherent strategies to accomplish key objectives. So today's webinar is a collaborative effort of Economic Development Research Organization, the Daily Morning Bartha, and Syngenta Foundation for Sustainable Agriculture. The focus is to discuss the challenges and opportunities for youth engagement in food systems by focusing on four strategic interventions areas like policy and socioeconomic environment, institutions and intermediary organizations or multi-sector platforms, technological options, business infrastructure and regulatory environment, and last, individual skills capacity. So I'd like to present today's keynote presentation by Dr. Suresh Babu. The Suresh Babu is a prominent economist and a researcher who working as a senior research fellow and head of capacity standing International Food Policy Research Institute, Washington, USA. Sir, can you hear me, sir? Please.
Yes, I can.
Please, if you present your today's keynote presentation, please, sir.
Thank you, Hilal. Before that, I thought Mr. Farhad Jamil can say a few words about the Syngenta Foundation's work. Jamil, can you do that now? Is
yes,
the plan?
Yeah. Yes, sir. I'm going to Mr. Farhad Jamil, Country Director of Syngenta Foundation. Please say a few words about the today's webinar.
Good morning and good afternoon. Am I audible?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Thank you, sir, for giving me the opportunity. It's really my pleasure. So I would like to say something about youth and agriculture in Bangladesh. So many thanks for giving me the floor to say something about youth, particularly Bangladeshi youth and agriculture. When I want to talk about youth, few numbers always blink in my eyes that 1/3 of the country population is youth. 2.1 million young people joining the workforce in each year. About 11% of youth are unemployed, while the country's unemployment rate is 4%. And by 2050, 7 out of every 10 people will live in a city globally. And finally, youth are not interested in agriculture. Huge potentiality. So all these facts and figures push me what we can do and what actually we are doing for this year. Since we are focused on agriculture, and agriculture creates 40% of the country's total employment, we have many things to do for engaging this youth group. But definitely we need to work in a changing environment. We need to shift from traditional agriculture to modern youth attractive agriculture. We need to focus on youth agri entrepreneurship, ag digitalization, and yes, we are moving on that way. Syngenta Foundation for Sustainable Agriculture, we are a Swiss-based not-for-profit independent corporate foundation, visioning a bright future for smallholder farming. We want to ensure bright future, meaning make farming is an attractive profession for the next generation, which will be profitable, productive, and use modern technologies. Smallholder will be much younger in future and considerably fewer in number. They will be entrepreneurial, highly motivated to learn, improve and grow care firm and open to firm opportunities. We know this youth engagement and bringing a bright future is not an easy task, but definitely possible, followed by systematic approaches. We have set up some strategies and believe it works better for our country as well as globally. For example, we create option and choices for the young population. However, we put farmers at the center of our input systems. This ensures whatever the solution and service we develop, which is actually appropriate, timely, affordable, economically viable. Again, youth are very much tech savvy. We create access to services and solutions digitally, an effective and efficient way. Our presence in Bangladesh since 2011, we have been implementing several cutting-edge agriculture development projects, including agro-technology transfer and enterprise development, crop insurance, market development and promotion, urban food and nutrition system development, economic empowerment of indigenous Santal people, and actually our work is overall agriculture value chain strengthening and economic ecosystem development. All our initiatives are smallholder and youth-centric. Though there are several definitions of defining youth, however, we prefer the definition of the National Youth Policy 2017 of Bangladesh that defines youths as individuals aged between 18 to 35 years. We understand that it is difficult to directly engage this large number of youth in agriculture with their own intention, particularly to the educated youth. The educated youth prefer the urban jobs, even though that are less profitable for them. So human labor-centric traditional agriculture is not respectful and actually attractive for this young generation that actually we saw. So we have settled two strategies. One is to create startup agri-entrepreneurship with an institutional business shape, which is mass attractive for the rural youth. And the second one is to promote mechanized farming, which is less human labor-centric. In Bangladesh, northern and western part of the country, we established a network of 350 branded agri-enterprises called Farmers Hub by engaging rural youth entrepreneurs. Farmer Hub is a one-stop commercial service platform, creating access to quality inputs, farm machinery, market, and knowledge. And each of these rural youth entrepreneurs earn on average $3,500 to $6,000 net profit annually. And they create 7 to 8 jobs for other rural people and serve 500 to 1,000 community farmers in that their area. So this is kind of examples. So my final word are, if we really want to target the youth in agriculture, we need to set some categorical interventions, enhance individual capacity, equip them with tools and technologies and business plan, and create an enabling environment that they feel really respect in their profession, and actually they can engage with the potential agriculture sector of the country. They engage with the agriculture system, create their own employment, and as well as serving for the other community people, farmers and youth entrepreneurs, and actually they will act as an, finally I can say, youth can be a change maker for the traditional to modern agriculture in future. And this is very much essential for Bangladesh. Thank you so much.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much for your kind words. Now I would like to request to Dr. Suresh Babu for presenting today's
theme. Join with the meeting ID.
Presentation. Dr. Suresh Babu, do you hear me, sir?
So you can join with the meeting ID.
Sir, Dr. Suresh Babu, sir, please.
Yeah, I'm trying to share the screen. Can you see the screen?
Yes, sir, it's visible, sir.
Okay, let me make it full slideshow. All right. Thank you very much for inviting me for giving this presentation at this very important meeting organized by EDRO, Bonik Batra, and Syngenta Foundation for Sustainable Agriculture. It's very important that that we all take stock of where we are right now in terms of encouraging agriculture, youth in agriculture particularly, and also specifically the entrepreneurship nature of youth in agriculture in the context of South Asia. I'll be kind of giving a overview set of ideas based on our work in the last 2 to 3 years, working with Syngenta Foundation as well as other partners in the region. And of course, we have panelists, very eminent panelists who are in the field, involved in youth development. They will be talking from their own country perspective after this. But please see my presentation as just an overview of the issues. And I'll just quickly move into the presentation so that we can talk more about it in the context of each country soon. But the emerging trends, Mr. Farhad Zamil already talked about in the context of Bangladesh. He talked about why youth are very important and how they can play an important role in agriculture and what are the challenges they face. But more importantly, we need to be thinking about what opportunities that youth have in agriculture and how do we create that opportunity for the youth in agriculture and agribusiness. And at the same time, what contribution meaningfully they can make to agriculture sector and how they can fit in with the role of private sector coming in, agribusinesses coming in the food system transformation that we are talking about right now. The efforts that we have made in the past in most of the emerging economies and developing countries, in order to engage youth in agriculture and in agri entrepreneurial activities, at best has been fragmented. But then we can learn from the best practices and the lessons that the countries that have successfully implemented policies and programs on youth engagement in agriculture. So that's the idea of this presentation. So quickly moving on, when we started looking at the issues related to youth in agriculture, youth entrepreneurship in agriculture, we wanted to develop a framework with the colleagues at the Syngenta Foundation and other partners that with whom we worked. And while going through the review of the literature on youth entrepreneurship in agriculture, we kind of came up with how the youth as a group of individuals are transformed from untrained, unemployed, you know, rural youth to very successful entrepreneurs at the end of the process. And that process itself takes various contextual factors and the key drivers that drive entrepreneurship. So in that context, we kind of divided these factors into 4 set of factors that you see here in the 4 quadrant. To start with, on the top right-hand quadrant, you have policy, environment, and regulatory system in a country. The broad policy enabling environment, right? So we'll talk about that in a minute. Keep that as a policy environment as one set of factors. And then you also need institutions and intermediary organizations that facilitate and support youth in entrepreneurial activities. That is the quadrant you see on the southeast quadrant, right? Bottom right quadrant. And then you also need the support of the infrastructure, both in terms of technical infrastructure, the business infrastructure, and that can support the youth involvement in agriculture and entrepreneurship. And that's what we have given in Southwest quadrant, And then finally, individual and personal qualities and skills and capacities make a big difference in driving entrepreneurial activities in agriculture. So that is what you see in Northwest Quadrant. Okay. So with that in mind, let's go dig a little bit deeper into what factors and what drivers that we should be thinking about when we analyze the issues of youth engagement in agriculture. And that that is something that we have been able to look into the literature, and also with the case studies that we have been working on, we have been able to come up with that factors and drivers. Let's quickly look at the policy environment. I won't go into them detail, but for the benefit of the audience, I put it all in the slides. So you take this first set of factors and drivers, think about the policy and enabling environment in which the youth had to operate. And in the context in the context of the factors that drive, or the factors that provide the opportunities in this broad area, you are talking about political environment, for example, for the development of youth and for youth mobility in a country. Okay, if youth are freely able to move on from one place to another, is something that drives the youth involvement in agriculture. But then that can be organized through policies, national youth policies, existence of youth policies, and how much are we investing in the youth, in youth development particularly, right? So that's one factor. Like, quickly moving on, you also need to look at the public-private partnership that gives opportunities for youth, and but that requires how the policy system is, you know, established in terms of entrepreneurial systems in the country, right? To bring them together with private companies, public sector organizations, and so on. And also the factors related to infrastructure for business, and also accessing the assets such as land and markets, for example. And that requires, of course, policies related to, and the environment related to, the agribusiness strategies and policies, right? And the value chains development and so on. And we also talk about in this set of factors, governance and judicial system. Functioning of judicial system very important for creating opportunities for the youth and also to represent themselves. And when the dispute comes in the marketing arena and also in the trade opportunities that they have. So you need to be thinking about the governance and judicial system as well. And then you have credit and financial system supporting them, business environment, and also functioning land markets. If they are going to be accessing land, is there a functioning land market, for example, and access to land as a driver for the youth. And of course, finally, the gender, youth, social inclusion are very important policy factors that we need to consider. To what extent they are taken seriously in the policy debate needs to be considered. And gender mainstreaming itself in the context of youth development is very important. So that's one set of factors. Keep that in mind. And as you come from your own perspective, think about what is available, what is missing, what can we do better. So I'm going to quickly move into this institutional factors. Again, there comes the enabling business environment. So we talk about we are recently in the news, if you look at the World Bank news about doing business in the countries, become very important factors, right? And that World Bank also looks at doing agribusiness in the countries. So where does the country that we are working on stand in terms of enabling business opportunities for agribusiness and youth? And that requires, you know, consultation in terms of drivers, multi-stakeholder approaches in terms of linking youth to the market opportunities. Who is enabling this business environment for the youth? And how the education that youth goes through also provides opportunities for accessing knowledge and skill development. Okay, we can talk about the educational institutions in terms of agricultural universities on the one hand, also the agricultural vocational training institutions that can build skill for agribusinesses, right? And here we have a colleague from Sri Lanka Dilini, Dr. Dilini will be, who is from the university, for example. Existence of chambers of commerce in the rural towns that we want youth to get engaged in. And the support of these chamber of commerce for youth development in the region that they are operating in. Okay, that's something that we need to think about. Skill development institutions, I talked about the vocational training institutions and also extension systems that encourage and build youth capacity, right? That at the same time, we're also looking at civil society and farmers-based organizations, FPOs now that are emerging, and how much they are able to promote youth. That I think Mr. Mendu Srinivasan will be talking about that, because he has done quite a bit of practical work in that area. And we are also talking about youth associations and networking and mentorships and institutions, formal and informal associations. The Lions Club and then Leo Club, Rotary Club, and then the clubs of the youth clubs, right, in the rural areas. And again, how can we build the technical and agribusiness capacity at the post-secondary level is very important. And of course, connecting market institutions to access to market is part of the institutional development and intermediary organizational factors. Let me move on to the next set of factors, which is basically technological options, right? In the context of business development, regulatory environment, what is available for us in terms of developing technological options in the value chain development, for example. How do we develop effective partnership? The development of infrastructure in terms of telecommunication and ICT adaptation, for example. Now we are talking about artificial intelligence. We're talking about precision farming, bringing in ICTs in machine learning and so on. But how do they connect the youth to the data that is on the ground, the technology on the ground, and connecting them with the market information, price information, and so on. So that's one area of broad availability of technology and innovation for the youth to operate and access of that technology as a driving factor. Then we are also talking about value chain development opportunities, agribusiness incubators as a part of the technological opportunities, and also academic and research linkages in terms of connecting technology that is coming out of universities and research institutions and making them available to youth for guiding their entrepreneurial ecosystem, right? And then we are talking about regulatory environment in terms of food safety and how a food processing environment where regulatory systems are very important and how youth can actually come and take support from that system. Finally, information and knowledge system for youth and also accessing such information. And broadly, the infrastructure such as storage, logistics, rural roads are very important in terms of technologies. In fact, the Bangladesh colleagues can talk about that. And I was impressed by the rural Bangladesh storage structures that are developed all over Bangladesh. Maybe we can talk about it. And also, I invite our colleague Maushimi, if she has joined from Nepal, for technological options that she is using in her own entrepreneurial effort. Finally, I'm going to go to the skill level at the individual level. Individual level, the factors in terms of whether the youth come from a business family, a family that supports the youth for moving into entrepreneurship, and that kind of factors drive the attitude, incentive, and motivation of the youth in the agribusiness arena, right? And also availability of professional incubator system where youth can be mentored and trained in learning the skills for businesses and also accessing the knowledge and research information through learning soft skills and exposure to businesses that are already there. And that is where the mentorship in business, networking in business, again, Mendu Srinivasan will talk about that, business attitudes and so on. And I also invite the panelists to touch upon these things because, for example, Nepali colleague is going to talk about her own business that she has developed and she is managing it in Nepal. So with that, let's move on. A little bit of a case studies that we have done and what have we learned using this kind of drivers and and the contextual factors, we apply that at the country level case studies. We go and look at what is happening in each country, and also go and talk to the entrepreneurs themselves to see what made them successful, what challenges they are facing, what constraints they have to overcome in order to become successful entrepreneurs. And then what are the solutions that we can give for policy and institutional and technological level, right? We'll look at that. See, one of the interesting things that we looked at beyond South Asia is Nigeria as a country. In Nigeria, when we looked at, I'm putting Nigeria as an example because it has very similar kind of environment, policy environment as South Asian countries, but also a challenging environment for youth to come in. A huge youth population in Nigeria that is waiting to be tapped into agriculture. But then the policies and strategies do exist in terms of youth entrepreneurs. They recognize the need for youth to come into agriculture, but the translation of the policies into strategies and investment is still a challenge in Nigeria. And the development of youth ecosystem is been happening, but it's a bit slow. For example, institutions are catching up, but then they are inadequate to meet the growing needs of the youth. Value chains are not very well organized for youth involvement, particularly because even the regular businessmen are finding it difficult to latch on themselves to the value chains. So youth are not having their own space to come in, right? So we have to recognize that also. And youth venture into businesses with high level risk and failures. That's a very major factor that prevents another youth to come in, because they see the one youth moving into business and then they fail, and there is a fear of failure, right? So this is particularly very obvious in Nigerian context, and maybe also similar to our environment in South Asia. We'll talk about that. And in the context of working with the system there, and I've been working in Nigeria for almost 15 years now, to look at various opportunities for agribusinesses, agricultural strategies in general, and also bringing agricultural extension to play its role in terms of bringing youth to agriculture and agribusinesses, right? So one key lesson that we can take from Nigeria is that multi-stakeholder platforms organized by agricultural business associations can help. And also the mentorship programs, handholding of youth in terms of education and building capacities, skill building particularly, so that better equips youth to come into the business arena. Initial capital and systematic access to investment also helps, but that doesn't happen all the time. That is still a challenge. Social capital is very key for survival for a youth, young entrepreneur. Connections, networks, and that are supported by agribusiness incubation centers, which are still emerging. We can talk about that in the South Asia context. Digital and social media needs to be speed up, for example. And of course, linking youth entrepreneurs to ongoing programs in extension, input delivery, seed production mechanisms, output aggregation, processing industries are all very important. But who is going to do that role of connecting youth to the business opportunities is still a question. And that's something that Youth Syngenta Foundation is working on. And let's move to the next case study right at our backyard, where we are organizing the seminar now from Bangladesh. Bangladesh is again a huge youth population, as Farhad Zamil mentioned. Bangladesh has some very effective youth policies and strategies in relation to agriculture. Very well-defined policies. If you go to the Ministry of Agriculture, where my colleagues are working towards developing youth in youth marketing, the policies are there. And there is recognition of youth entrepreneurs in value chains also. It's been very high for some time, particularly in the value chains such as poultry, for example, fisheries, aquaculture. Youth is playing a major role there. Business ecosystem to support youth. has been developing fast in the last 10 years, but still not covering the whole country, where we need to give some attention. Agricultural output marketing and input supply are the key activities right now. When you look at where youth have opportunities as well as engaged currently. Rural infrastructure is developed well, fairly well, so that the roads are connecting to villages everywhere. The transportation mechanism is in place, and the storage mechanisms, for example, I mentioned about that storage structures. For example, if you travel in Rangpur area, you will see government-sponsored storage where farmers can store their potatoes and other crops, you know, usually that is well developed there. Youth participation, however, is missing due to high level of urbanization. Youth would rather go into the urban areas because even the parents prefer them to go to urban areas rather than staying in rural areas. So there needs to be some high level attractiveness for youth to stay in agribusiness and work in rural areas. So that's something that we can think about in the context of Bangladesh. What lessons we learned is that this, like I said, policies are recognizing, particularly the youth. Here, what you see, I wanted to put this picture mainly because the youth, when they are provided opportunities, for example, to create nursery as the one that you see here, supported by Syngenta Foundation particularly, we studied that very carefully, are able to supply nursery to quality nursery, particularly the seedlings, to throughout the villages, which creates the increased production through productivity increases, and which can be brought back in terms of output aggregation and supply that to the urban areas. So that has been a successful operation, which can be replicated in Bangladesh. But let's come back and listen to the Bangladesh colleagues more on that. And now we also have quite a bit of youth programs in India. Mr. Mendu will talk about that, but I just want to touch upon how India itself is taking. It's a huge country, as you can see. The state level implementation of youth policies differ from state to state, but broadly there is recognition of youth in the broad national policies, agriculture programs, and huge level of support at the community level for youth in terms of getting involved. Now, the new laws that India has implemented in terms of Essential Commodity Act, APMC Act, for example, and the FPO, or the Contract Farming Act, all these provide opportunities for youth to get involved in agriculture, agribusiness. But then there are opportunities that we need to tap into by training the youth properly to come in and providing them opportunities there as well. So the case studies that we studied include quite a bit of women youth in agriculture. Here we are discussing with the national award winner who mobilized self-help groups, women self-help groups, to produce quality seeds for vegetables and maize and soybean, and were able to sell in an organized manner. And that's one example of how the productivity of youth, the maize cultivation in the region has increased because of this youth entrepreneur coming into to playing their role. But again, it's important that we recognize the challenges that they face in terms of contract farming, how much contract can be held with the people, how FPOs train the youth, and how the agribusiness themselves in terms of input dealers operations and the aggregators coming in are providing competition for the youth, and how youth can compete in the entrepreneurial system in the Indian context needs to be studied further. So with that three kind of case studies, let me quickly talk broad policies that we need to look at as recommendations, and then quickly finish this presentation. And of course, the country level panelists can expand on that. The agribusiness ecosystem needs to be developed for youth entrepreneurship. And that's something that we need to be consciously developing. And again, in the context of bringing stakeholders together and youth being one of the stakeholders, how can we promote multi-stakeholder engagement, right? And in that, the national youth policies need to be relooked and revised in order to target this kind of specific issues that we need to look at. Promoting transparency and accountability in the governance structure so that youth can benefit out of that transparency, and also promoting policies related to credit, insurance, infrastructure, and extension services, market support are very important for youth to participate. Institutional recommendations, again, the credit is important, insurance is important, access to them is also important. Technical institutions, particularly in rural areas, which can train youth to support in terms of technology and agribusinesses is also key particularly. And developing those institutions and reach of those institutions for the youth is key. And improving market access, for example, for involving youth in and then so that they can connect to smallholders in rural areas where they have limited transportation and access to the market, youth can play an important role. Facilitating that is in itself is an important. NGOs that are working on youth, mainstreaming youth strategies, developing their own inclusiveness strategy, and enabling their programmatic activities towards youth is very important. Sometimes we have programs, intervention programs on the ground, but then they don't take youth into consideration, which is very, very, very important. Moving on to the technical part of it, we need to continue to tap into this youth engaging in ICTs. If you see, every youth wants to have a smartphone. But then what is the use of having a smartphone and doing all this chatting when they can actually be using it for business purposes? How do we translate that opportunity for them to penetrate the market, get involved in the agribusiness is very important, right? Accessing high quality and low cost input, and they can get involved in the development of the markets, input markets in itself. In India, particularly, we talk about doubling farmers nowadays. And the doubling farmers can happen through reducing the cost of inputs, increasing the productivity of agriculture, and increasing the price that the farmers get. In all these areas, youth can play a role. And how they can play a role is something that we need to help them to play in terms of connecting them to the regulatory system, introducing them to the opportunities in terms of processing the commodities, value chain operations, and then identifying new commodities that they can operate in. That's very important. So efforts are needed to improve the regulatory business environment that are conducive for youth to operate. Let me move on because of want of time. Individual capacities are important. See, I see when I go to the rural areas in South Asia particularly, there are a lot of youth coming, educated youth. They study BA, BSc, MA, MSc, and things like that. But they don't find jobs in urban environment for just such kind of education because some do, but then they are not highly technical education, right? So they are broad education, but they need to be brought in, given some exposure to agribusiness, and they can take on their rural opportunities. On the one hand, you have agribusiness graduates themselves coming into the market, but then they can play a different role in terms of mobilizing this youth rather than, and also they can become entrepreneurs themselves, but they can engage this youth in the rural areas. We need to think about a business model, how the agribusiness people can engage the rural youth and rural youth themselves can become entrepreneurs. But that again requires building the hard skills and business skills and soft skills as well, because we don't build the leadership skills of the youth. And that's where people like Mendu Srinivas can come and give us our ideas for how we can build that. So let me move on beyond that. The case studies that we are developing are showing some ideas about where to tap into the business ideas for policy changes, institutional changes, and also mobilizing youth in a community level, for example, FPO level, for example. We can talk more about that, but let me give this overview back to you. And then listen to the panelists who are actually doing the work on the ground. And then we can talk more in question and answer session. Back to you, Hilal. Thank you for the opportunity.
Thank you so very much, sir, for your nice, concise, and resourceful presentation. And we have already learned such a presentation. Now I'd like to I'm going to Mr. Mendu Srinivas, founder and mentor, Social Advancement Venture Foundation, India, who has been working various organizations related to agriculture and agricultural finance and development. Mr. Mendu Srinivas.
Yeah. Greetings to everyone. Thank you. So thanks for inviting me to this wonderful session. This is very important topics, actually, when we are talking about youth entrepreneurship and agribusiness development. They go hand in hand when we typically look at our own economies. It depends on the agrarian sector. So from Indian context, I would like to bring our experiences, what we have been going through, to address some of the most pressing challenges what we were discussing now. Especially what we believe is that doing just agriculture is not going to help anybody, because we have already seen on ground that millions of farmers have been doing this agriculture for several decades in Indian context, I am talking. But their economic empowerment is still lagging. That is one of the reasons why the government of India, in the first term of its government, the present BJP government, when it comes to the power, they focused on policy changes where doubling the farmers' income is one of the top priority for them, they put it. Whereas the benchmark of the average income for Indian farmer stands somewhere about just 80,000 rupees per annum. So not even 100,000 or something like that. So it's very, very low. And second thing is that to double that agriculture income of the farmers, government also focused on doubling the agri exports. So these are the two major things they looked at, but in the first 5 years, it didn't happen, but it's only sensitized to the key stakeholders on the ground. So based on those experiences, the government, when it has come back again to the power next second term, in the year, last year in 2020, the government has made more relevant policy changes, which are going to trigger towards achieving the objectives which are actually not able to fulfill in the first term. Some of them are, as Suresh Babu already mentioned, that the policy reforms of agriculture market committee yards reforms, and then as well as contract farming legalization, then also the Essential Commodities Act things as well. But in this, what is helping the farmers now is that to move towards smart agripreneurs. See, earlier, it's just like an agriculture. Most of the people, they feel like, okay, we are doing an activity which we are already engaged in for several decades. But now, the thought process essentially is changing towards the business context. Because people are realizing by the sensitization of the various key important authorities in the government or universities or in the industry are coming together and then sensitizing them, it is important for you to do with a business sense. So here, again, we have challenges because most of the population, say, for example, in Indian context, if you take that, 14 crore farmer families, most of them were small, marginal, or even semi-literates or illiterates like that. So because they are all aged. So, but again, another way, if you look at that, half of the population is under the youth category now. So huge population. And 35% are less than 24 years old. So this is another opportunity. On one side you have a big problem, one side you have a big opportunity. So being smart agripreneurs is the necessity now. So to achieve that, one need to understand the production requirements, like adapting to the good agriculture practices, and also to overcome the challenges traditionally what the farmers are facing for years, like not able to access the quality inputs right from the seeds, nutrients, and plant protection inputs, and as well as farm machinery. And also there are huge losses after the post-harvest storage, as we know that. The statistics says that somewhere about 100,000 crore per annum India is losing at post-harvest storage losses every year. So these all, how we can address that? And even we can talk about irrigation, cost of irrigation is very high because one side less than 50% of the agriculture land in India is under irrigation. But at the same time, a lot of pressure on the other resources like electricity, governments, some states, they have their own policies to give free power, and then the misutilization of this. All those things are actually building pressure on the ecosystems where the agribusiness is actually under cultivation. So to address these things in a systematic manner, it is very necessary to become a smart agripreneur. Every farmer should become towards a smart agripreneur. So that what we said, whatever the gaps are there, like right from establishing the biodiversity within the farm, so to make sure that there is a very good ecosystem in place, and having collaborations with the right and credible stakeholders who can supply the quality inputs, genuine plant and plant protection inputs, plant nutrient inputs, and as well as farm equipment, the smart irrigation equipment, everything, and including the output market linkages, processing and all. So whatever the dots are there, the problem is a lot of inefficiencies in the existing system, lack of presence of credible partners in everywhere where the farmers are actually performing their tasks on the ground. So to address this, the government now has come with another good policy, is that to promote farmer producer organizations, FPOs. So the FPOs is not actually very new to India, but the way it is revolutionized as a companies, farmer producer companies, is something new. And the farmers are actually earlier used to become small groups with a common objective of addressing the challenges what they used to have in terms of the production, or processing, marketing, or accessing to quality inputs or financial services, risk mitigation products such as insurance and all. So now some of the good case studies we used have in the past, and then that has actually helped them to move from just only being to cooperative spirit to including the corporate thought process as well. So a hybrid model where cooperative spirit and as well as the corporate thought process to do the business has come into the place where the government has structured under the farmer producer companies. And also there are institutions like the Small Farmers Agribusiness Consortium, SFAC, and NABARD, then NCDC. These are the primary institutions which are helping these FPOs to be formed across the country. So the government of India is encouraging now to form the farmers into the groups as farmer producer organizations. So they have set up a target of promoting 10,000 farmer producer companies in the next couple of years, by 2024. So already we have 7,500 plus, but there are a lot of challenges for them because this concept is new, and the farmers, we all know that they used to have so many struggles while they're into only production. But now they need to come together, sit together, and then set up a common vision for all the hundreds and thousands of the farmers who are members of such kind of FPOs. And also they need to make a plan for mobilizing the resources across the value chain from the credible institutions. Again, I'm saying that's very important. And again, to prepare a business plan and approach to various funding institutions, including some grants from SFAC or NABARD, and some mainstream commercial funding as well from the formal financial institutions such as the NBFCs or now banks. So they are supposed to help the farmers. So it all requires professional kind of services. So farmers will not have a good and a sufficient time to deal all those things, although they represent in the board, but making the decisions once in a while, because they are occupied with their own production aspects and family matters and village aspects. So here we see a lot of opportunity to for the youth to come into this, probably the local youth or even any youth nearby areas where they can be engaged with the FPOs as a professional service providers. This is the one of the important aspects. Now we are seeing the big revolution is coming in India with this setup of opportunities were coming in that. So the universities earlier, they used to have a program called RAVEP in terms of providing some practical learning for the students when they are studying agriculture BSc. For some period of time, they keep them the villages students and learn from a particular family as an individual. So those times are gone now. And this is the time with an industrial approach where the farmers can be brought into the institutions like FPOs, and then the youth also attached to them in the groups. They were put in the villages or a cluster of villages and led them to understand across the value chain. The perspective development has to happen, not just only in the seed area, not just only in the fertilizer area, or just a farm machinery area. So they have to go through everything so that this will help the youth also to learn things while they are in college itself, practically. So they will interact with several farmers who are best practitioners, also the solution providers to whom they have access. This will really help them a lot to develop their perspective. Either they want to pursue their own entrepreneurship, or they want to go to some particular industry, seed industry, or research and development, or financial industry, insurance, or irrigation, whatever it is. Then, most important thing is that, again, food processing is another important area where really the value addition is happening, where the value proposition is coming to every key stakeholder. So there, the youth can look at that, because this is the huge business segment. If you look at Indian agri business, overall potential is $350 billion per annum. So that's such a massive that in this huge potential is for the food processing. So now in the recent trends, when we look at that last 5 years and even 10 years also, horticulture and fruits and vegetables are on rise. The cultivation, consumption, and the market share is actually on the rise significantly. But still,
sir, please. Finish my 2 minutes.
Thank you. So these are the two things what you actually, I believe that youth should be given handholding while they are in the college, universities to help them to connect with the practitioners, to enable them to have deeper knowledge, about the policies, and again, the market innovations, and again, about the financial aspects. The business thought process is very important. Otherwise, just being a theoretical thing is not going to help that. So interlinking with the producers through the farmer producer organizations and policymakers and the youth at the industry, and then the mentorship programs from the institutions like SAFE Foundation, Syngenta Foundation, and there are institutions on commercial basis which are working, like for example, DHAT, Refresh, and even Digital Green, which is working on the knowledge base. So my suggestion is that credible partnerships are very important, because we cannot waste our time again to do experiments. We need to build from where already credible examples or proof of concepts have been established well. And the governments need to come forward and to set up a kind of a fund, and leveraging some fund from the CSR budgets also, whichever the countries in Indian context, there's a huge money available under the corporate social responsibility. They can also come and then support for these kind of initiatives. This is what all I would like to bring it, and I will be happy to give more insights if any further questions are there specific on that. But FPOs, yes, this is the best thing where youth can be part, because they are the local farmers, and also youth as professionals coming from professional universities also can come and serve them. And even in pandemic also, we have seen that these FPOs have done tremendous agribusiness with companies like Baycool and all, the market linkages seamlessly developed, and they are making money, they are into the profits. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so very much. I'm inviting Dr. Dilini Hemachandra, honorable panelist, on today's seminar. The faculty member of University of Paradeniya, Department of Agricultural Economics and Business Management. Sir, you have 10 minutes. Just finished your speech by 10 minutes. Dr. Dilini, do you hear me, sir?
Thank you very much, Helal. Thank you for inviting me to represent the context in Sri Lanka. Let me start with some statistics on the labor force on Sri Lanka. So we are a small country compared to other countries in the region, just 22 million population. And the working population is about 8 million. And however, only 2.8 of the total working population identify themselves as an employer or a business owner. Now, if you are familiar with your country statistics, you should realize that this is a very low percentage compared to your countries. And the youth population is defined in Sri Lanka as those between the age of 15 to 29 years old. And that comprise of 23% of the population, that is about like in millions, 4.4. And male and female ratios are more or less equals. About male youth is slightly higher than the female youth. And so given that, let's also look at the nature of the agriculture sector in Sri Lanka. The contribution of agriculture to the total GDP has been decreasing over the time, as most of us have experienced in our development path. So it is only 7% as of now. However, about 80% of the rural population is still employed in agriculture. And if you look at the total population, about 30% is directly or indirectly engaged in agriculture. So you can see, compared to the contribution to the GDP, the labor or the population, the numbers engaged in agriculture sector is quite high, which implies the low productivity in agriculture as well. So apart from that, the agriculture sector of Sri Lanka is experiencing diverse issues, providing negative consequences to the progression and sustainability of the sector, starting with, as I told, productivity stagnation, a high production cost, marketing issues, food insecurity, resource degradation, health hazards, climate change uncertainties, and agrarian poverty, lower product diversification, and lower innovativeness. So these are among the key concerns in the context of current agricultural sector. With that, the youth engagement in agriculture is on the decline, and the research has shown that among all the other employment prospects, agriculture sector is the least preferred sector for employment, especially among the youth in rural areas. And the studies have also found that majority of farmer parents do not like their children to become farmers. So farming has become unattractive to the youth. So therefore it is important to support more young people to develop agricultural enterprises and view agriculture as a viable career option. With that, let me also talk about the context of agriculture education in Sri Lanka. Now, even though the agriculture sector's contribution is small, and even though the number of jobs created in the agriculture sector is like the paid jobs in agriculture sector is not high, the country produces over 1,000 agricultural graduates each year. And decades ago, the public sector used to absorb the large majority of agriculture graduates, but the public sector is no longer able to absorb as many because large governments have become a burden to the country. And also because of shifting economic priorities and labor market trends, the government sector is unable to provide jobs for these large number of graduates every year. So therefore, in this context, a more strategic focus on linking the agriculture sector, agriculture education, and development priorities of the country is essential. There's this term that we use, agripreneurship. entrepreneurship in agriculture is of course an obvious choice there. Now, universities have identified this need and have introduced entrepreneurship courses in agriculture degree programs in almost all degree programs offered in the country. And also the agriculture faculties or colleges, if that is more relevant to your country context, have introduced entrepreneur incubators. They try to link the interested students or early graduates to linking them with the funding sources and giving them an office space to start with, likewise. So these agriculture entrepreneurs can contribute immensely to the development of the sector while uplifting agrarian communities. So if agriculture graduates, without waiting for the government to give them jobs or the private sector to absorb them, if they can start their own business because they have the knowledge, and it will be a great contributing factor to the uplift the agrarian communities. Other ways that this can help would be improving food supply and nutrition, and value addition to underutilized agricultural products or crops, technological development, expanding commercial orientation of farming activities, rebranding agriculture through high quality products, enhancing the quality of the value chain, and grabbing export market opportunities. All these are possible avenues to explore for the young entrepreneurs. Now, I gave you a background to the labor force and to the agriculture sector, and also about the agriculture education to some level in the Sri Lankan context. Now, if I talk about the entrepreneurial culture in the country, the country does not have a supporting ecosystem for entrepreneurship. That is why I told that about 2.8 of the total working population can be identified as a business owner. We see most of the entrepreneurs are push entrepreneurs rather than pull entrepreneurs. This means that people turn to entrepreneurship by necessity rather than opportunity. So a shift in this pattern is required, because push entrepreneurship is less likely to contribute to innovation and to the diversity in the local markets.
So you have just 2 minutes to answer.
Yeah, so Sri Lanka needs to make entrepreneurship a viable career for the majority. Now, some of the constraints for the entrepreneurship in Sri Lanka is social stigma. As I told you, it is not considered as, or it's not sought after as a good livelihood. And lack of technical skills and training, and credit constraints. Now, credit constraints to business startup is one of the major factors that has hindered young people from starting business. And however, we see that there is a new trend among youth through digital platforms. And we see students which are having, which are having a computer science background, has a tendency to start digital businesses. And however, only 5% of these companies have earned from the revenues coming from outside. So you can see the export market is very less explored. there are government programs to support young entrepreneurs, especially new startups, providing finance facilities. There are programs like Turunu Divya, a government program to give credit facilities to young entrepreneurs. And another important category is identified as not in labor force, education or training. We can call them NLET. They are not in the labor force, but by removing constraints, we can improve their labor force participation. So there are 8,700 youth between the age of 15 to 35 in this NLET group. They have left the labor force because of certain constraints, especially women, because they have to take care of children who are elderly. But through digital platforms, very easily these can be brought back to the labor force, and they are one of an important stepping stone for that is as on-account workers. So it has been found that on-account workers can be, like within 3 years, can be easily to SMEs, where they will be providing employment opportunities for few other people. So with that, I would like to conclude the context about youth entrepreneurship in Sri Lanka. Thank you.
Thank you so very much, because our time is very short. We just have to end. Now I'm inviting Ms. Moushumi Srestha. Moushumi Srestha, do you hear me?
Yeah, hello.
Moushumi Srestha is the director of Srinagar Agro Farm, and she has a wide experience in the area of poultry, livestock, and aquaculture sector. I'm inviting Ms. Moushumi Srestha for delivering his valuable space.
Yeah. Good afternoon, everybody. This is Moushumi from Nepal. I'm a social entrepreneur and a director of social Srinagar Agri Group. Today, I'm going to present youth and women and agri-entrepreneurship in agri-development in Nepal. So how innovations in agriculture and food sector can bring changes. And I'm going to share my own experience, what I'm doing practically in Nepal in the field. Yeah, so I'd like to start by quoting George Washington's very famous quote that agriculture is the most helpful, most useful, and most noble employment. And in case of Nepal, agriculture and food, the total population, 60% of the people are engaged in agriculture. According to International Labour Organization, agriculture provides 68% of Nepal's total population, accounting for 34% of the GDP. Nevertheless, Nepal struggles to produce an adequate supply of food for its citizens. So though 60% of the people are engaged in agriculture, it's contributing only 34% of our GDP. It clearly shows that many people are involved in it, but still we have a productivity issue, and the contribution from the agriculture is still not adequate as per the expectation. And just coming to our company, it's Srinagar Agri Group, is an integrated agribusiness company with an aim to energize Nepalese agronomy by providing all sorts of services that a farmer needs. We just don't want to be an input provider. We want to be a service provider also. So we are right now working in the concept from farm, feed, and food. In case of farm, we have GP farm, breeder farm, hatchery, contract farming, broiler, and we are also trying to work. Our major core business started from poultry. We started our company with 2000 layer farms, but now we have expanded, and now we have parent farm, hatchery and all. And we are also trying to work in the crop, because especially maize, because for our feed industry, the major crop that we require is maize. So we are trying to also streamline the supply chain. And we are the first company to introduce the floating fish feed in Nepal, the technology that we got from China and Holland and Bangladesh to introduce the fish feed. And now we are also expanding our business into warehousing, because the warehousing concept is totally new in Nepal. It's not yet there. So we are trying to set up 3 warehouses in Nepal from east to west. And we have started entering into the food line also. So we don't yet have the slaughtering, but we have partnership, and we have we are working buying back the goods from the farmers and branding them in the name called Sunaulo, brought them into the market. And we have also cafe and restaurant. We also trying to make like, we have a main logo of our company is like Srinagar in making of Sri Kishan, which means that we're trying to be a one-stop solution to the farmers, where we supply chicks, feed, services, and market linkages to the farmers. And we try to empower our farmers and ensure them they become a progressive farmers and become Sri Kishan, that is the smart, skillful and successful farmers. So we are also working, so if you look at the Nepal map, our corporate office is in Kathmandu, but our main working area, farm and factory, is in the central western part of Nepal, that is called Lumbini province, where the birthplace of Lord Buddha. And we have set up our agri centers in various parts of Nepal from east to west. So the concept of the agri center that we are trying to work is to supply chicks feed, technical assistance, skill development, access to finance services and insurance, and then buy back good from them and help to set up a small outlet in that agri center so that they get a full service of the market linkages at their destination. So I would just like to touch a little bit on how we as an working in agriculture sector are vulnerable to different kinds of crisis, flood, earthquake, COVID, you know. So in this presentation, I would just like to touch like what are the risk factors that we are facing from the health wise, the hunger wise, and the farmer's livelihood. So when it comes to the health risk for the farmers, food production is essential for survival. And we always see that people working in agriculture sector are the frontliner. During the COVID time, we felt that, I mean, everyone was noticing that doctors and nurses are the frontliner, how they're serving people. But being in agriculture sector, I realized that we are also one of the frontliners who are committing and dedicating our life to produce the goods so that we can maintain the supply chain and supply agricultural products at every household, even during the lockdown time and even during the crisis time, like what we just faced within past 1-2 years. So the inadequate health facilities and tracking in the rural areas is one major thing that I found. And that these farmers have insufficient knowledge and health precautions, and livestock farmers are in constant contact with animals and insects, chemicals and fertilizers, dirt and mud. So due to the lack of strict regulation, vendors and farmers are in contact with thousands of customers. So, you know, we were saying that please maintain distance, don't meet people, but still, you know, we were facing all kinds of these problems. So we found that there is a huge health risk among the people who are working in agriculture sector. So government and the policymakers should always think how we can minimize the health risk for the people working in agriculture sector. And then comes the case of hunger. When the COVID-19 hit us, there is a high risk, the number of people facing acute hunger from 135 million to 265 million. So we felt that unless the certain action is taken, is going to be a huge problem. So I've just pointed out a few things that we had faced, that the food availability was severely impacted. Food accessibility was decreased to the consumer access, food reduced, and diet diversifications. Millions of families dependent on remittance sent from the workers abroad had to come back to Nepal because there was a huge unemployment, especially in the tourism sector, also in the Middle East and all. So we faced huge coming back of the migrant workers back to Nepal, and the quality of the food had gone down, and there was a high impact of food waste. So the sustainability issue was also a big concern because there was no market, the tourism had really collapsed. So these are the issues that we faced. So, and the income and consumption of food in Nepal, as per the WFP data of October 20, we found that there was a food insufficiency. There was a huge shortage of food, increase in price, no money to buy food, no food in houses. And when we looked at the average days of consumption of food groups, we saw that there was a huge decrease in the consumption of goods like meat, eggs, and fish, because it's a little bit considered as a high value food products. So there was a huge decrease in the consumption. So, and then the farmers' livelihood was also highly affected. There was a supply surplus, no shortage storage facilities. It was restricted in the movements. There was market unavailability, reduction in the demand from the food service sector. Many restaurants and hotels were closed. So it has caused a high pressure on the income of the farmers and severely affected in the standard of living, you know. So we as our company, how we are fighting back in this kind of pandemic, keeping these three things in our mind. So we try to like really see how we can really minimize the health risk of our workers and farmers and the consumers. So by implementing health safety, and so I'll just touch upon those three points, how we try to minimize the risk. So implementing health and safety measures, maintain social distancing, and maintaining made sure that our workers were wearing protective gears. And we did the farm and health insurance. We did COVID insurance to all our staff. And we tried to introduce as much as possible digital transaction like phone pay, online services. And we also introduced remote monitoring of our farms by introducing Internet of Things and introducing a smart farm concepts among our farmers. And then on the hunger side, we try to ensure that like food safety and nutrition security is still there. We try to identify the demand and supply gap, and we try food systems. We try to be operational and open as much as possible, taking the permission from the government. And we really try to promote balanced domestic products rather than import, and reach out to the vulnerable communities. We also did egg distribution in the slum areas, where especially targeting the daily wage workers where they were really suffering because of the COVID. And we tried to really introduce regulations on food safety and hygiene among our suppliers and the buyers and the wholesalers. And we did lots of activities on awareness of the balanced diet. And then the protecting of the livelihoods, we try to motivate the youth to generate employment by doing conducting a skill development program and try to really improvise on the shortage and the logistic management, especially lobbying with the government, especially for the movement of our trucks and vehicles. And we really try to lobby the government for the rebate and subsidization for the agri debts and the promotion of agri insurance during our training programs. And then market development with innovations, processing and packaging. And we really made sure that how we could minimize the food wastage. So as a social entrepreneur during the COVID-19, we would like to proudly say that we were acting as a first responder to the crisis by providing jobs and access to products and services and offering relief to the vulnerable communities on the ground. Few innovative things that we introduced was like keeping farm and factories operational and follow biosecurity protocols, regular PCR tests and insurance of our staff, lobby the government to permit operation of our business, online technical services to the farmers, conducted online training, skill training classes to the farmers, and especially targeting the migrant workers. Then we introduced the contract farming concepts, which is still a new concept in Nepal, and then streamlined the storage system and cold room. And then we introduced a new app called Golden Fresh, Golden Food app. And during this lockdown, we developed this app and we delivered food, home delivery. And as we, as I mentioned earlier, that we have a restaurant and cafes also, but which was all shut. Then we tried to mobilize all our chef and kitchen staff to come up with the new concept of ready to cook products. So we came up with 35 different varieties of ready to cook products like marinated chicken, yakitori, tikkas, and you know, varieties of products, and momos, which is a favorite of all Nepalese. And we have a wing called Sri Kishan Innovation Hub also, which is a knowledge wing and skill development wing of our company, which provides online technical services to the farmers. I, as mentioned, conducted different kinds of online trainings. And we have been also in trying to introduce low-cost innovative technologies like demand feeders and IoT to monitor the farm activities. And we've also introduced the blockchain to track flow of eggs to streamline the supply chain so that customers get assured like where they're getting their eggs from, and we try to introduce the transparency. And I would like to say, you know, that leaders on the front line are the agri entrepreneurs, and we must make sure that young and women entrepreneurs are there in the are there, and the community's voices are heard. We must prepare to respond, recover, and rebuild, and take the opportunity to shape a new tomorrow. Integrate and collaborate across sectors to reduce the complexity of the crisis, and empower by supporting with the access to finance and insurance. Upskill and support young and women entrepreneurs and support their social ventures. Yes, now being a woman, I always try to see how women get really involved in agriculture and empower them, because women has art and skill to balance work and family. When women are economically empowered, investment will always be in the right place, and innovations and agricultures are definitely going to reduce the women's drudgery. So we always try to see how we bring in innovations to in reduce the drudgery. And youth in agriculture, we always try to motivate youth in agriculture, because it, I consider it as the most respectful job with self-identity for the youth of Nepal. And digitization will attract youth in agriculture, and it will reduce the migration. And only youth can bring creativity in the coming days, because we have to come out from this traditional approaches and come to a, new approaches for the commercialization. So I would really like to encourage youth to come into agriculture. So I just like to show a short video, which Tyson Group, when they visited Nepal, tried to capture my story.
Shimish Rashtra. Together with my husband, we started Srinagar Agri Farm in Nepal. This 2015 earthquake was a very, you know, scary. It shook the whole Nepal. We never thought that that kind of damage, you know, would happen. The shake, the trauma is still within us, which is so difficult to express. When we went into the field to see the farmers, to see the community, the people living in the camp, it was really disheartening. It opened our eyes that why don't we as a company also start doing something and change the life of the people with one egg. There is a big problem of malnutrition in Nepal, which is due to lack of protein. And I think we can solve this problem by donating eggs and feeding children at least one egg a day. If you look at egg, it is really small, but it is very rich in nutritional value, and it is one of the most affordable protein you can find. As transportation is a big issue to deliver eggs in these schools, we thought of building a network of farmers around these schools. So we trained these farmers to start their own poultry farm, and after a few months, we started buying back those eggs from these farmers and started delivering these eggs in the schools. At present, we are donating 5,000 eggs every week in 7 schools to 700 kids. I think it's just the beginning. Our goal is to reach out to 7,000 kids in 2 years' time. Just donating egg to the children is not enough. It is equally important to bring awareness about the importance of eggs to the children, to the parents, and to the teachers. We will even take education of protein nationwide.
Does he remember when he found the very, very first egg?
I'm really excited about this partnership of Srinagar with Dyson Food, Corp Ventures, and One Egg. Together, we are going to build more farms and donate more eggs to more schools.
The work that Mashimi's doing with One Egg in Nepal is inspiring. She's helping children in some of the most vulnerable communities in the world to be nourished with protein. She's working with entrepreneurs to empower them to create financial stability in their communities. When we talk about raising the world's expectations for how much good food can do at Tyson, I can think of very few examples that represent that better than what's happening here.
Thank you. So I strongly feel that sustainable agricultural production, food storage, food security, and subsidies are more important than ever. If the natural agriculture process is interrupted, there will be consequences more disastrous than the virus itself. So we need to act, and we need to act fast, because there's one thing that needs consistency is agriculture, and it must never stop. Yeah, and thank you. I feel that we as a South Asian countries, we should all come together and really try to see how we can be number one agricultural continent in the world.
So, thank you. Thank you very much, Moshe Srestha, for your nice presentation and very informative presentation as well. I'm welcoming Dr. Mahmoud Jahangir Alam, sir. Professor of Agribusiness and Marketing, Bangladesh Agriculture University. Welcome to our webinar. Sir, do you hear me?
Yeah, good morning. Hello. Yeah, I can hear you.
Sir, please, don't miss your valuable speech in this session. Webinar, sir, please give me words for today's webinar regarding youth entrepreneurship and agriculture in South Asia.
Once again, thank you, Halal, for asking me to say something. First of all, I would like to thank you, your organizations, to organize such a very valuable youth entrepreneurship in agriculture. It's very demanding, particularly in this pandemic time. So I would appreciate this one, but in fact, I missed the initial presentation, so I didn't hear. But I don't know that whether already Suresh or other colleagues presented, but I'll be happy to listen then, and then if there are any comments that you are expecting from me, then I'll be happy to make comments or any questions if there are. So thank you so much, Halal.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much. Now I'm going to Dr. Hassanai sponsor, sir, the leading researcher and economist of Bangladesh. As we already know about her, his profile by MD Tanjil Hussain. Dr. Hassanai Mansoor sir is now, it's currently the Executive Director of Policy Research Institute and Chairman of BRAC Bank. He has already a visionary career in the sector of economics and as well as he is working on IMF and other organizations. Now I am inviting Dr. Hassan S. Mansoor sir for delivering his valuable space for today's webinar.
Good morning to you all. I'm speaking from Los Angeles at the moment, so it's quite late tonight. But anyway, let me first thank you, the and the organizers of this event for an excellent area of presentations and topic is very pertinent. Topic is very pertinent because agriculture, although share in GDP in Bangladesh has declined over the years, but still employs about 40% of our workers. And that's
sir, your video is off.
I'm intentionally leaving it because I'm in the hotel room.
Okay, sir.
So I intentionally kept it that way. So please excuse me because I'm in a travel mode. So what I wanted to emphasize is that inherently farmers are entrepreneurs. They survive by selling their products, producing things for the market. And increasingly, they are market oriented. They are no longer the subsistence farmers that we used to think of. All this illegal boro production and so that they end up in the market. So they are very much an entrepreneur. Issue is that, are they efficient? Are they smart enough to adapt new technologies? We know that they're hardworking, but that's where the problem comes. And how you transform these farmers into a class of entrepreneurs who knows the market, who knows the product selection, who knows the range of products, et cetera, to make a smart decision regarding their operations and how that can happen. Because an individual farmer cannot form an ecosystem. There is an ecosystem in Bangladesh. Of course, farm produce ends up in Dhaka, the final consumers, or in any part of the world, many part of the world, and also in any part of Bangladesh. They appear. The mangoes grown in Russia, everywhere in Bangladesh, which is grown in that. Marketing system works. It can be much more efficient. Production management works, but it can also be much more efficient. So that's where the issue lies. And the issue also lies in the sense that more and more rural, educated youth are leaving the villages. And they are not being attracted, find it attractive enough to work in agriculture. And that's a mindset problem. It's not that agriculture necessarily pays you too less, no. If you can increase your productivity, you can definitely create an income level, which is equivalent to what you are earning outside the villages. But the mindset is that I don't want to deal with dirty my hands or my clothes. At the end of the day, I want to be clean, sitting on a chair. That's the mindset. Then, of course, you have a problem. And we know that migration is a natural phenomenon. From rural to urban is part of economic development. It's going to happen. But we need at least a minimum core people in agriculture who will drive the future productivity of Bangladesh agriculture sector. We look at Bangladesh's agriculture sector has been mostly driven by what we call the global green revolution phenomenon. Essentially driven by seed, irrigation, fertilizer, irrigation pumps at the electricity at the irrigation pumps and at subsidized rates. These are the driving forces, and the government has played a significant role in that domain. Not being directly involved, but creating supply sources directly as well as encouraging the market to come into play. And that's the optimal mix. We may not have found the optimal mix yet, but we are searching for it, and that's the challenge. these ag interventions over the years has obviously helped Bangladesh a lot and many other countries. And it has increased the average productivity significantly in such a way that Bangladesh has increased its rice production, for example, almost 3 times from 1971. Bangladesh is almost self-sufficient in the main staple crop rice. We have hugely increased our production of fish. We have hugely increased our production of vegetables, varieties of vegetables, milk, also diversified agriculture as well. What that by that I mean is that there has been diversification in the crop sector, but there has been diversification away from crop as well, which is poultry, which is animal livestock, which is fish. And these are actually becoming almost as important as the farm production. Farm production accounts for about 8.5% of GDP, and then about 6% or so comes from other agricultural activities, like what I say. So agriculture in that broader concept has now become a much more rewarding for rural population. And why I'm saying it is because in many ways, rural people don't depend on agriculture for the most part of their income. 60% of income comes from non-farm rural economic activity. And that's a major shift. And 40% from farm sector. So that's the mix that is helpful. And that has contributed to what we call the standard of living of the rural population in Bangladesh. In many respects, they're quite well off compared to 30, 40, 50 years ago. Every house now has television, many houses have refrigerators. These are becoming common household items. So it's a blending of agriculture entrepreneurship as a farmer, along with agriculture marketing and the related service industry that has developed the ecosystem, the rural economy, that has contributed to, first of all, education for the children, healthcare for the children or the family, nutritious food for the family. So, and good what you call living condition, means that the houses are now bigger, more structurally strong, cleaner, toilet facilities there. So these are all part of the ecosystem development that has made that. Now, challenges, challenge should always be here. First of all, we still have to go a long way to absorb a lot of rural population away from agriculture into the non-farm and in the industrial and other service sectors. That's a must. And secondly, along with that, we have to increase agriculture productivity, which is quite respectable in Bangladesh, but quite a bit more. Why not like Vietnam or China? If we can do that, we can reduce our workforce, we can reduce our land area, and still happily feed all the population all kinds of nutritious food ingredients of various types. So that's the challenge. And for that, we need younger generation to come forward and work in agriculture, follow the footsteps of their father, but in a much more smarter way, in a much more efficient way, so that they can be part of the ecosystem, derive benefit from that, and also contribute to that. Mindset is a problem. We have to work on that. And I think NGOs, government, and business houses who are playing a role in the agri sector, they all need to work together to change that mindset. If we can do that, I don't see a major problem in our agriculture sector or our food security and our nutritious, despite very high dense population in Bangladesh. So it's a very positive story for Bangladesh, but we can make it even more positive if we can really triangulate government, NGO, and business community to encourage and develop the ecosystem that will work for value enhancement for the farmers, the intermediaries who will be in the value chain for the food processing industry leading up to that. And the food processing industry, for example, it just started in Bangladesh, done quite well. It has a lot of future. And it has it needs a lot of integration with at the farm level. That's where the efficiency has to come. And the challenge, that's where the challenge lies. I think overall, Bangladesh economy has done well, and well, it has served. The agriculture sector has played a great role in where it stands. The farmers have done a phenomenal job through their hard work, but there is a need for encouraging the younger generation to get into the farming, younger women in rural areas to get into, and they're already getting into that poultry. Poultry is mostly at the household level, managed by women in Bangladesh. Fisheries, into cattle, milk production, and all those things. So there is enormous potential if we can really develop the ecosystem whereby the products can be sold at a fair price, at a predictable price, to the larger business houses or the commercial enterprises, hook up with them. In that case, we can really, I can say that we can really transform our agriculture sector to the next level. We are at intermediate level. We have done quite well, but we can do much better. And for that, I think our media, our media, like, for example, I watch movies like, I watch the TV program like by Shaikh Shiraz, for example, and several other television programs are running on agriculture programs, successful entrepreneurs in all across Bangladesh. And there are so many of them. You really feel proud. You really see that people are changing their own fate in their ways. And people, by seeing those media programs, are also transforming themselves and thinking themselves as farmers. So I think that we as a society, we need to make it in such a way that people feel that agriculture is a worthy profession. It is the most original profession as the civilization came out of caves. It will remain as the worthy profession for the next future generation as well. It is not something that our fathers or forefathers did, and we don't want to do. Let's change that mindset. And you can really have a equally comfortable, equally productive, equally income earning, income generating activities in the agricultural sector, which will help it and lead to the prosperity of the households and the children and the family, their health care, all those things. So it has to be looked at in a very holistic approach. Bangladesh is, in some sense, has done quite well. The road network in Bangladesh is extensive. It has really helped the agricultural sector very much. We need to maintain them. We need to make them more up to date in the sense of the modern market connectivity and so on. And the government is thankfully focusing on those areas, despite some problem in many certain aspects. So I'm really hopeful that we can initiate a social movement to create that kind of a mindset which will take Bangladesh agriculture by the younger Bangladesh population to the next level. And the next level, where I would like to see our productivity increasing by another 40 to 50% in the next 15-20 years time. And that, if you can do that across the board and increase the range of products in all types of agro-related activity, Bangladesh's food security and Bangladesh's rural income will be unmatched in the South Asia context, definitely, and will be also comparable to those of many other countries which have much higher level of productivity and income at the farm level. And that's the future forward. And young people must be motivated. Young, educated people must be motivated to be part of that agricultural ecosystem so that they can contribute, they can remain connected with their villages and have a very good quality of life for their family. If we can do that, I think we will have what you call a sustainable food security with very strong, very highly rewarding agricultural income for the farmers. And that's the kind of outlook we must work for and strive to develop in Bangladesh. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much for your valuable speech on today's topic, youth entrepreneurship and agricultural development in South Asia. Informative speech by Dr. Hassan S. Mansur, sir. I am now going to the question and answer session. I urge all participants to ask questions maybe the panelists or the keynote presenters. If you have any questions, you can.
Hassan, sir, I would just like to know how the BRAC Bank has prioritized the agriculture sector and what are its strategies to motivate the farmers to come into this line and what kind of packages you've been offering for the agricultural community.
Thank you. BRAC Bank has a social model, and the objective is that to help this small and medium enterprises develop and grow in Bangladesh. You know, the 53% of BRAC Bank assets is directed towards the small and medium enterprises, and that is the highest in Bangladesh context. And we believe that we can increase up to 60% or more and still remain a mainstream bank, but at the same time catering to the needs of small enterprises. Agriculture fits into that border. Agriculture, I look at it, agriculture as an entrepreneurship. Farmers are entrepreneurs. They make decisions based on the market, based on the weather, based on technology. I was amazed that that farmers were buying even 2-3 together harvesters, and because the labor cost has increased, harvesters become economical. Government gave a subsidy, and in my own village, there was one harvester, and now there are two harvesters this year. Next year will be 3 harvesters. There's not space for more than 3 in the whole village because there'll be too much. Then we don't have that many left. But see, people are innovating. People are trying to make alternative sources of income, also contribute in terms of productivity or prevent crop loss. So these are all being funded by not necessarily BRAC Bank alone, but funded by government, funded by non-government private banks and other sources. So we very much working on those areas, and the agricultural credit loan is a mandatory requirement for all commercial banks in Bangladesh, because Bangladesh Bank has made it mandatory that a certain percentage of loan has to be given for agricultural sector. So that also helps agricultural sector financing. But that being said, I will still say that access to finance is still a major problem in Bangladesh, and we still have to go a long way in ensuring that farmers and the people associated with the ecosystem, with the farming community, have access to credit. I always want to make a cautionary note that sometimes we wrongly discriminate against traders. We call them hoarders, we call them market manipulators, etc. But to me, they're market players. And the young entrepreneurs coming from rural areas, they should go to that business. And they should be allowed to operate unhindered, in the sense that there should not be like chadabaji and all kinds of things which does hamper shipment of movement of goods and from various regions, one region to another. So we have to also give them the access to finance, so that they can store it, they can preserve the value, they can take it to the destinations where there is a market differential arbitrage opportunities, and create the uniform structure in the process. That's the best way to develop. So we should be non-discriminatory. We shouldn't discriminate against the agricultural market players. They are as important as the producers. Your product cannot reach my table in Dhaka unless there are intermediaries in the agriculture sector, and they have to be treated also with respect and with access to that. If you can ensure those things, I think and along with the development of the food processing industry value chain, we can really see much faster and remarkable.
Oh, thank you, sir.
I've got two questions to Dr. Delaney and Mr. Bindu. Would you give me a chance to ask the questions to the speakers?
Sure, sir. You can.
I would like to ask to Dr. Delaney that how many people are involved in the agriculture sector in Sri Lanka, and what is the how much percentage of GDP is generated from agriculture sector? And the another question to Dr. Mr. Mendu is that India is agriculture agro-based country as far as that. So what is the percentage of GDP that is generated from agriculture in India? Can you tell me? Okay, thank you.
Thank you very much for that question. So agriculture's contribution to the national GDP is just 7%. As I told, it has been declining over the time. And the participation in agriculture in terms of employment, 30% of the population is either directly or indirectly engaged in agriculture. And from the rural population, it's about 80%. So in terms of number, from the total population, about 7 million is engaged in agriculture-related work. Thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah, thank you. In India, around 54 to 60% of people are depending on the agriculture sector, whereas the GDP contribution is coming close to 17%, 16 to 17% from agriculture. We are seeing that there is an incremental trend now, whereas the horticulture rice contributing to the agriculture sector and value addition into the food processing. I think this will significantly increase in the coming years.
Very nice. Thank you very much.
My name is Muhammad Khairul Islam. I have a question to Hassan Munsa, sir. If you allow me, I can ask a question to sir.
Sure, please. Concrete.
We know that fourth industrial revolution is going on. And in such a situation, if we want to keep the sustainability of agriculture, we need to introduce artificial intelligence and robotic tools and equipment in agriculture. And without it, it is very difficult to increase the productivity and efficiency of agriculture. In such a situation, what should we do and what could we do? It is my question to Hassan Mansur, sir.
I should say some words about Khairul Islam. Khairul Islam is the assistant professor of Ratsey University, the Department of Economics.
Thank you. The question you raised is pertinent for all sectors in Bangladesh. Because every sector is going to face that challenge. And every sector has to cope with it. The way I see it is that you cannot think of introducing artificial intelligence or those other things at this point directly to the farmers. But certainly, the agricultural commercial enterprises who can intermediate between the two. Like you have a hatchery, you have a poultry farm, and you have, say, 1,000 farmers who are supplying, taking the chicks and supplying them. In that case, the core or the hub is the commercial enterprise. And that commercial enterprise can do that. Like, for example, I have visited BAT, British American Tobacco, tobacco cultivation and commercialization. This is very fascinating. They have a very high productivity because BAT provides the technological support. BAT provides the seeds, BAT provides loans, and BAT ensures that these tobacco leaves are bought back at a pre-declared price. So there is no loss. If we can develop a similar concept, I don't think because we are in the wrong business instead of tobacco, go to the commercial agricultural farming, you will be successful. So the model can be replicated and is being replicated to some extent in parts of Bangladesh, but not widely. And those enterprises at the core, they can definitely adapt the latest technology and provide the technological support to the farmers. Farmers themselves will not be able to capitalize on it. If the chemical contents in the fish pond has changed for worse, the testing mechanism and things may be simplified and farmers sometimes can do it. But more sophisticated testing will require a commercial entity to support. Otherwise, it will be very difficult for the small farmers. We cannot think of Bangladesh without being small farmers. They are there. How we can engage them or convert them into a more productive small farmers by hooking up with commercial enterprises, by hooking up with market, by hooking up with adaptation of technology through government and also the commercial enterprise. That's how the productivity will come. They themselves will not be able to innovate. They themselves will not be able to even practice food. But they themselves can be the beneficiary of the ecosystem that I was underlying before. If that can be developed, they can be the beneficiary. Without taking the risk, without taking the investment, without taking having the knowledge, the benefit of that industrial revolution that we're talking about.
Thank you, sir. I enlist myself from your answer and from your lecture also.
Thank you, sir. Any question from other participants or? I think there is no question.
Hey, Murshad, Shekhar, can you ask some questions? Would you like to ask?
Yeah, can you hear me?
Yes, we can hear you.
Yeah, hi, I'm Mohsen Rahman Shekhar. I am working as a data collector in Economic Development Research Organization. Recently, a few days ago, we have completed a research on the topic of role of small and medium enterprise to reduce poverty and unemployment problem in Nansing. I have a question to Dr. Afan Mansoor, sir. That on that research, we have seen that small and medium enterprise, most of them were relating to agriculture, and their complaint was against the banking sector, both private and public. The government bank, according to their complaint, they couldn't get bank loan without giving bribe to the bank officer. And again, on the part of private bank, their complaint was the interest rate was too high for the fresher and for the small enterprise holder. My question is to Afan Mansoor, sir, that this banking interest percentage, do you have any plan from your authority that about reducing the interest rate for the fresher to develop their business in future? Thank you, sir.
Thank you. I mean, there are two types of problems that we face with respect to access to finance. Particularly, access to finance is a major problem in rural areas. And much of it is being met currently by what we call microfinancial institutions. But the interest rate of microfinancial institutions are indeed very high because of two, three things. Number one, the sector is high risk. Secondly, management cost is very expensive relative to the loan size. And because the loan size is very small, it's costly to manage the portfolio of loans. And so that's one thing. But at the same time, when it comes to commercial banks, the government has recently introduced a cap. So any loan that's offered by the commercial bank cannot exceed 9% at the moment. And I think that is a very attractive rate for borrowers, particularly SME borrowers. The issue here is the capacity of institutions to manage those portfolios and interest of many of the banks in getting into the SME sector. SME sector, including agricultural SMEs, they are inherently risky. And it requires a lot of local level knowledge for the banks to deal with those, which the MFIs have. But MFIs' interest rate is 25%. Banks' interest is only 9%. So if the banks can do it, it will be the best thing for the borrowers. Issue is that how many banks can do it? Not many. Bank is an outlier because it can do it. I have seen that during the pandemic even. We could extend our loans to the SMEs, and we have been very, I would say, very satisfied that our client base could sustain the repayment and everything at the 10% interest rate. And still the bank could make a small margin of profit. The issue is that, for the most part, private banks, government banks have the problem of this bribery and other things. That's the problem. And access is very much restricted in the sense that only those with intermediaries and so on, they will get the loan. Others, normal farmers, may not be entertained at all. For certain institutions like IDNC, Black Bank, and others, they can operate in that area. If we have more banks which develop the capacity to operate in the SME sector, in agriculture and non-agriculture, we can really turn around. millions of small enterprises, cottage industries and others to become much bigger and play a dominant role in the economic system of Bangladesh. But we don't have that many banks. And that is, we have many banks, but most banks are not interested in getting into the service sector. And that's where the challenge is, right? I think competition is coming. Bcash, which is a subsidiary of Bragg Bank, and mobile financial service providers like them, in future, will also be providing loans to small enterprises in future. That they will depend on technology. And technology can play a very important role in reducing the cost of intermediation. And if that happens, the spread will go down, access will increase, and competition will bring down the whole interest structure for the SME and rural borrowers from the micro enterprises. And one of the things that I'm saying to our micro enterprise people, including DAC, is that competition is getting going to be intensified. And as the competition picks up, there will be three major players: MFS, Mobile Financial Service, which is expanding very fast in its network, banks with their agent banking operation, expanding very fast. Bragg Bank is also doing it, and many other banks are also doing it. The traditional MFIs, microfinance institutions, will be squeezed out. And they have to be more competitive. They have to adapt more technology in order to survive. So the number of MFIs will go down. They will not be able to sustain the competition, but we'll have more efficient MFIs. We'll have more efficient mobile financial service providers, and we'll have more efficient, what we call agent banking activity to cater to the needs of the very small enterprise. That happens, then we'll have much better access to finance at much better interest rates, and agriculture, non-agriculture, all other semi-sector players will benefit tremendously in the future. But technology adoption will be central element in driving that process. Thank you.
Oh, thank you, sir. Now, I'm going to end up this to this webinar. I'm inviting Musa Bhai, Deputy Managing Editor of Bonik Barta. Musa Bhai, just say something. Can you hear me? Musa Bhai, are present here? Sorry,
hello.
Out of network. Yes, sir. So now I'm.
Musa Bhai, are you there? Dear brother Musa Bhai. I think he is not available.
I'd like to request MD Tanzil Hussain, Executive Director of Economic Development Research Organization and Associate Professor of Economics Department, Jatiyoga Vikajinus Islam University, for a speech, a vote of thanks, then concluding that was this session to this webinar. Now I am requesting.
Thank you, Hilal Ahmed Johnny, for your presentation. Actually, today's webinar is the title of today's webinar is Youth Entrepreneurship and Agriculture Development in South Asia. Actually, South Asian countries are unemployment problem faced country. That means the unemployment problem in South Asian countries, including Bangladesh, India, Sri Lanka, Nepal, all the countries have been facing acute unemployment. In Bangladesh, right now, 26 lakh persons are unemployed. So the economy is divided in broad three categories: agriculture, industry, and services, as you know. So Bangladesh is an agro-based country. Here, about 48% people directly related to the agriculture sectors. And indirectly, about 70% people are related to the agriculture sectors. About 30% GDP have been generated from agriculture of Bangladesh. But the employment opportunity is very limited in service sectors and industry sector. As you know, service sector generate little amount of, although in Bangladesh, 50% GDP is generated from service sector. But the employment generation is relatively low. Industry contribute about 20% of GDP, but here employment generation is relatively lower. So agriculture is the main subsector where a lot of people can be engaged, because in agriculture, relatively little amount of capital is required to generate employment. But according to our honorable panelist and popular economist of Bangladesh, Ahsan Mansur sir, have told that the mindset is the main problem here in Bangladesh. The graduated and educated people don't like to involve in agricultural entrepreneurs because there is a status problem in Bangladesh. Someone think that after graduating, after literating, after educated, I don't like to involve in agriculture profession, because there is related to the status and honor. So we have to retrieve the mindset. As you know, our honorable panelist, Mr. Mendu Srinivas, have told that about 54 to 60% population are involved in agriculture in India, agriculture in India. And GDP is generated about 17%. That means about 60% people are generating only 17% of GDP. So there is a huge problem in India also. There is some problems and challenges. We have to find out the problems and challenges. In Nepal, our honorable panelist, Mousumi Sharmista, have distinguished and explained very nicely. And she has done a very important thing. He formulated a agro-based industry, which is very important for other countries of South Asia, including Bangladesh, India, Sri Lanka, Pakistan. We can formulate and we can establish such kind of industry, I mean agro-industry in our country, which provide lot of employment opportunity. It will give our safe and good food, which is the main goal of our United Nations the Good Food System Summit, which will be held on 23rd of this September. So agro-based industry will play an important role to reduce unemployment and to provide good and nutritious food to the people. And in the unemployment prone countries, especially in the South Asian countries, it can be an example to provide the employment, to reduce unemployment and to eradicate the poverty of the people of the South Asia. Dr. Delaney explained very clearly that in Sri Lanka, only 7% of GDP is generated from agriculture sectors, and about 30% people are involved in the agriculture. Among them, 80% are rural people. Actually, in rural area, people are mainly based on agriculture. So I would like to ask concerned authority and all the policymakers and the here, print and electronic media, all are here to publish the news that the mindset have to be changed to the young people and youth, that agriculture is the honorable profession. It can be honorable profession that has been created in other countries such as the Nepal through the Srinagar agro based group of industries. So this can be the very important thing. I should say something about our honorable keynote speaker Suresh Babu sir. IFRI, International Food Policy Research Institute, and Syngenta Foundation for Sustainable Development in Bangladesh have completed a research, and the findings is disseminated by our keynote speaker, Dr. Suresh Babu sir. Dr. Suresh Babu sir have finded out some factors that can play an important role for youth entrepreneurship. And he has explained some challenges to youth entrepreneurship and agriculture development in some countries, including Bangladesh, Nigeria, India. There are institutional problems, there are access to finance problem, technological problem. And that's why the policymakers, NGOs, academicians should come forward to work together to eradicate unemployment, to generate employment and agriculture development. And I would like to thank all the panelists, including Dr. Dilini Hemchandra from Sri Lanka, Mr. Mendu Srinivas from India, founder and mentor, Social Advancement Venture Foundation. I'd like to thank a very impressive presentation presenter, Mousumi Shrestha, director, Srinagar Agro Group of Industries from Nepal. I'd like to thank our respected and popular economist and our beloved person, Dr. Ashton H. Mansoor sir, Executive Director of Policy Research Institute and Chairman of BRAC Bank. I would like to thank Country Director of Syngenta Foundation for Sustainable Development, Mr. Farad Jamil. I would like to thank to Hilal Ahmed Johnny, my associate researcher of Economic Development Research Organization. I would like to thank GTB. I would like to thank ETV to come forward to cover the news. I would like to thank Bonik Batra, the popular newspaper of Bangladesh. I would like to thank Financial Express. Financial Express, Tonmoy Bhai is the eminent journalist. Tonmoy Bhai is presenting here. And eminent development journalist of Financial Express, Dr. Humayun Kabir Bhai, have facilitated us to cover the programs. I would like to thank Mousumi Shrestha for giving information to Nepalese journalist. I thank Mendu to bring this news to the Indian e-magazine of agriculture to make this program successful. I am indeed indebted to the Dr. Suresh Babu sir, who make this program very fruitful. And he cooperated me all sorts of things, and he bring all the panelists to me to make this program successful. I am really indebted to Dr. Suresh Babu sir for his kind cooperation, and we hope that we will arrange such kind of programs in the days coming ahead in South Asia all together. Thank you, everybody. Hello, Ahmed. Can you say something?
Thank you, sir. Thank you for your nice speech. That's all for today. Thank you for from the panelists from USA, Nepal, Sri Lanka, India, and Bangladesh. Thank you all, audience. Thank you, press, and print and electronic media. Thank you for your nice cooperation. And that's all for today. Thank you very much. Love it.
Thank you. Thank you.